Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This is Talk a Book. I'm Arifa. At Talk a Book, we are reading books in an interesting and innovative way through videos, pictures, and living legends have also joined us while we were talking upon the book, The Habit of Winning, written by Mr. Prakash Iyer. A wonderful book in which Sir has put up some very important and essential qualities required by leaders and winners. And one more very important and lovely thing about this book is that he has put up all these qualities in the form of stories, examples, and anecdotes, which makes it so interesting. And while we were discussing also, it was so interesting to discuss. Well, this experience of 15 sessions of reading this book has become immensely memorable, and it will stay with us for a very, very long time. Living legends who joined us during these sessions were Mr. Faiz Fazal, who is an Indian cricketer, Mr. Meer Ranjan Negi, who is an Indian hockey player, Mr. Moin Malak, who is an Indian golfer. All of them joined us and talked about their styles of winning, their styles of leadership, and even failure to success stories. Well, all together compiled, actually, we have experienced this book. My aim of doing this is to take people to books so that when they pick up the book and read, it becomes so very easy to comprehend, as well as you adopt all those qualities in their lives. Also, foremost is welcoming our guest of the evening, who has made the evening so very special for all of us, the author of the book, Mr. Prakash Iyer. Mr. Prakash Iyer is a best-selling author, motivational speaker, and leadership coach. He has also been at the top of the corporate world and has had a rich experience of working with some exclusive teams and great leaders. Well, let me also tell you that he's a great fan of cricket, as also I am. Well, sir, I welcome you from the bottom of my heart, and also it is our utmost pleasure to have you on the session. I'll hand over the session to you, sir, for your talk, and then we'll go on to some questions from the participants.
Arifa, thank you so much for having me on this session, and hello everybody. I've been watching from the sidelines, and Arifa has been sending me these little updates and videos to tell me how much fun all of you are having, and I must tell you, I think you're lucky. You're lucky to be having someone like Arifa to kind of handhold you on this journey of reading a book. And in some ways, I think I'm lucky because it's my book that she's picked to do this session with you. I hope you've enjoyed some of the stories in it. But that's not the big deal. It's not, you know, it's not as if everybody will relate to every story in a book. But I'm hoping that at least one of those stories is kind of stuck in your head and saying, maybe I need to do something differently. And if that has happened, I think I'd say job done. The other bit, of course, is that the objective of this entire exercise, I think, was to get everyone to read. And I'm a big fan of the idea that people must read. And there could not have been a better way to get you started on this journey. And therefore, you know, to have Arifa for what you've done, which is to kind of bring those stories to life. Get them to talk about those, the entire book, not as, oh my goodness, one book, but really as a few simple stories that everybody can listen to and share and get excited about. I think it's a great idea. I also think it's so nice that you could get, you know, people like Faiz Fazal and Niranjan Negi and Moin. I think it just adds so much to what you've done for this. So, I am guessing that everybody else on this call wants to join me in actually putting our hands together for you, Arifa.
Thank you so much, sir.
I think you've done a truly great job. And I want to say this to everybody. I probably heard this very early in my life, that it's a funny thing about life, that all the good things in life are kept on the higher shelves of the shop. You know, so think of yourself as being in a department store or a supermarket, and that's what life is. The good things in life are all on those higher shelves, and they are slightly out of reach for most of us. But what happens when you read a book is every book you read puts like a page under your feet. And if you read enough, you will suddenly find yourself growing taller and taller, and the good things in life suddenly become, you know, within your reach. And that's the difference that reading can make to all of us. And I think somebody said this, you know, you should feel sorry not for illiterate people because they can't read, but you should feel sorry for those people who can read but don't read. Okay, and many of us, I think, we often say, "Kya kare? Bahut busy ho jaate hain, time nahi milta hai. You know, I want to read, but I never find the time to do it." And I think that's just an excuse. You should find, and if I would say that if you've enjoyed the sessions that Arifa has done for you, you should set aside maybe like half an hour every day and say, "I will read every day for half an hour." And you fix a time and you decide what time it is, preferably not the last half hour of the day, because that's when you're tired and you say, "Aaj nahi, kal se karenge." But find that half hour and read. And if you do that, take it from me, it will change your life. It'll change your life. Okay, you will become a far better person than you might have otherwise been. And I must tell you this, that I've just been a fan of reading, and it's not like I read everything. I don't read fiction. Okay, too bad. I don't read it. That's it. I don't have explanations for it. But I read a lot, and I read everything, and I read with a view to saying, "Hey, what can I learn from here?" Okay, and I use that lens with almost everything that happens in my life. So if I see someone on the street and somebody's selling bananas on the street, and I see a crowd over there, I sometimes look and I say, "Wow, what can I learn from here?" And maybe there is something you can learn from that lady who's selling fruit on the street. And it's for us to then say, "What's that lesson? What can we learn from her?" It's not as if all the best lessons are somewhere else, only in these big companies, or only in Google and in Amazon and Apple and all that, nothing like that. And I think you can find lessons all around us. So right where you are, wherever you are, you can find some lessons. It's for us to have a mindset which says, "How can I learn? How can I get better?" And to many of you, I know that all of you are successful in your own ways. You're doing things that you enjoy doing. But I think our success in the future will depend not so much on how good we are today, but on how we continue to get better. How can I get better? If you're not getting better, you're losing the race. And this is not a race where you're competing with someone else. It's just you. It's you and your life. And how good that life will really depend on how you continue to get better and become as good as you can be. And someone used to ask me this question in the days when the habit of winning was out, as to what does winning mean to me? You know, what's the definition of winning? Is it finishing first? Is it winning the gold medal? Is it beating the other guys? And my answer usually was this, that, you know, winning for me is really becoming as good as you could have been. Okay. And if we can all live our lives and at the end of it, put our hand on our heart and say, "I think, you know what? I think I did the best that I could have. I tried and I did justice to thy potential." And that's really what life is all about. It's not about saying how much, you know, it's not about money. And that's a lesson that I learned some time back. You need some money to live. You need some money to take care of your expenses, but that's about it. You know, I often say this, that, you know, if you've ever been to somebody's, you know, let's say someone has died and you've been to the ceremony where they are kind of celebrating his life, nobody says, "He was such a good man. He had 3 flats in Bombay." Nobody says that, right? Or, "Bahut achhe aadmi the, unke do gaadiyan thi." Nobody says that. They will talk about, "What did you do? How did you make other people feel? What impact did you have on other people's lives?" That's what matters. And I think it's important for all of us to figure this out for ourselves. What really matters? Okay. So don't go out there trying to play somebody else's game. Don't go out there trying to set yourself a target. It's like saying that, you know, a lot of people end up climbing the ladder, and when they reach the top, they say, "Oops, wrong ladder. Yeah? I shouldn't have been here. This doesn't make any sense to me." Okay? So I think it's important for each of us to choose the ladder that we want to do. And in some ways, that's the story of my life, because I used to be in the corporate world. You know, I started my life selling soap. And this is not to say that you must not, you know, I think I tried to do a good job wherever I was. So whatever I did, I tried to do a good job. And then, of course, I asked myself the question, what do I really want to do with my life? You know, and that's really what got me started on this journey of saying, nothing excites me more than knowing that I could probably make a small difference to somebody else's life, because I might have learned a lesson that I can share, and that lesson that I share might make a difference to that person's life. So I write, I speak, I do a whole lot of, I try and post something on social media. I try and share lessons. And the idea here is not to try and say, look, everybody, look, I'm so smart. That's not the intent. It's to say, you know what? I've also been through what you're thinking about. I've also struggled with it. And hey, you know what? This worked for me. Try it. Maybe it'll work for you. That's really what I try and do. I try and share some of the mistakes I made, some of the lessons I learned, some of the things I learned from great people who I worked with. And I say, maybe there's a lesson here which we can all learn, something that we can all benefit from. And that's really what I try and do. And I have two fundamental beliefs in my life. And okay, make it three. The first is I'm a big optimist. Okay? And I would encourage all of you also to believe that good things will happen. Okay, I think we have a choice at every stage. You can either say, everybody's out to get me, the world is unfair, I'm so unlucky, oh no, you have no idea how difficult it is for me. You know, we can keep looking at what's not working. But don't do that. I think be an optimist. And I've been a firm optimist all my life. And, since you talked about cricket, I'm the kind of guy who, if we need 19 runs in the last over, I would still think India will win. And if they need only 5 runs in the last over, I will still think India will win. So I'm a huge optimist. I believe in myself, in my team, in my ability to get it right. So I think it's a great idea to be an optimist. The second one, I think, is to take ownership for whatever is happening in your life. Don't blame anybody else for it. A bit of a mantra for me has been this line, and I know it's there somewhere in the book too. If it is to be, it is up to me. Okay. It's 10 words, all 2 letters each. If it is to be, it is up to me. And if you are the kind of person who likes to put a little poster on your bathroom mirror so you see it every morning, this is a good one to put up. Because it basically says that, whatever happens in my life, I am responsible. I'm taking responsibility for what's happening. If something good happens, it's because of me. If something bad happens, it's still mere karan hi ho raha hai. Achha ho raha hai, mere karan ho raha hai, bura ho raha hai, wo bhi mere karan ho raha hai. The minute you take ownership, I think you stop blaming other people. You stop looking for excuses. And you start saying, hey, how can I get this right for myself? And I think that is something that's worth doing. And the last lesson, the third one that I want to share with you right now is this, that, it's never too late to change. I'm a big believer that we can all change. We can all get better. So never fool yourself into thinking, no, but I'm like this. What to do? I am very short-tempered, or I'm very clumsy, or I am like that. Nothing is I am like that. If you think that's not good, you can change it. But you've got to work on it, and you've got to believe that you can change it. So I keep joking. People say, "Arey, what to do? I'm a Sagittarian, so I'm very clumsy." So what happens? You're clumsy. You keep dropping things, and you tell yourself, "What to do? I'm Sagittarian." So it's almost like if I don't drop it, there's a problem. Right? Now that's a bad way to do it. You got to tell yourself, hang on, yeah, Sagittarius is rubbish. I will not be clumsy, and I will start being more careful from tomorrow morning. And when you do that, you'll suddenly discover that the clumsiness goes away, and you don't make it an excuse for your behavior, but you start saying, I will make change happen. Okay. And that's really what I want to tell you, that each of us can change our lives. Each of us can make our lives a lot better. I love that line about how there's a Chinese proverb which says that, the best time to plant a tree was 20 years ago. The second best time is now. Right. And I think it's the time for us to change. So don't worry that I wish my parents had done this. I wish I'd gone to that school. I wish I'd gone to an English medium school. I wish I'd done engineering. I wish. Forget it. Tell yourself, I can make that difference today. Maybe I wish it was earlier. It is not earlier. But I can make a difference starting from now. That's all I have to say. Happy to answer questions.
So people, this is Mr. Prakash Iyer. That is why he's so different. He actually takes it to changing people's lives by the way he can put it up into words. So great life lessons, definitely. Well, in my sessions, I have varied audience. I have students, I have professionals, I have people right on the top of their careers also joining me. So I have questions from all of them, but I'll start with students. Few of them like Vinti, Rajat, Siddharth, all of these have a common question that we set a goal, but it becomes difficult to follow that one goal. At times we get deviated. We feel that maybe this is not good, we'll go to something else. So how to keep our focus intact?
I think great question. A lot of us as young people have these challenges. So the first bit is to remember, it's good to have a goal, a long-term goal, but don't get so caught up with it that you lose sight of the journey. So it's important for you to enjoy whatever you're doing. And, you know, between where you are and where you want to be, it's not a straight road. Often it's a zigzag road. You'll have to go somewhere. You'll take a diversion. You take the wrong road. You make a mistake, but come back. And I think the lesson to remember is to make sure that you don't lose sight of your goals. Okay, don't get so focused or so overly obsessed that nothing else matters. But don't lose sight. Remember, it's somewhere that you need to go. Something I've found very useful is to break that goal up into smaller, simpler goals. Okay, so that you're not worried about something that, you know, I will do this so that it's 10 years from now or 20 years from now, I'll make it happen. That's too far away, can't relate to it. So try and focus on more short-term goals. What will I do this month? What will I do in the next 6 months? What will I do this year? And as you achieve those goals, celebrate. So you start feeling good about what it is that you are doing.
So celebrate smaller achievements. Targets and achievements that you have. Yes, sir. Yes.
I think so. I think that can work very well. The other thing, Arifa, that I think has worked for me is sometimes we all worry about the goal, but we don't worry about the things that we will do. So I think it's a good idea to focus on what action am I taking and commit to the action. So an example for this could be that, you know, you could say that I want to lose 10 kg, you know, and get fitter, for example. That might be a goal. And you can worry about, oh no, what to do. I had this 10 kilo goal, but I, you know, yesterday I ended up eating some sweets and day before yesterday I didn't go for a run. So I'm getting distracted. But my goal is still there. I want to lose 10 kilos, but that's not enough. I think what you should do is don't focus so much on the goal, but on what action will I take and commit to taking that action. So one way to do it would be to say that I will walk every day, or I will run every day, or I will work out every day, or I will now choose what you want to do. And you make it your habit to say, I will do it every day, come rain, come shine. Okay. When you focus like that on the action you need to take, the goal will take care of itself. So don't worry about the goal. Worry about doing the right thing every day. Okay. So if you want to say, I want to be an engineer. So don't say, I must clear that entrance exam a few years later and become an engineer. Say, I will do some math work every day. Or I will make sure I do a project in physics every month. Or I will take extra classes. Or I will watch videos. I will do something which keeps me interested in the entire science space. That's a good way to get to your goals.
So true, sir. And as there's this famous line by Lord Krishna in Bhagavad Gita, karm kar, phal ki ichha mat kar. So you need to work to reach up to that goal. That's so true. Another student, Mansi Jain, she is an MBA aspirant, also shortly she's going to give her exam of IPM. Wishes to ask that how was your experience in IIM Ahmedabad? Do you miss those days?
These were great days and fabulous experience. Do I miss them? You know, by then you're as old as I am, you realize that you'll miss a lot of the stuff that might have happened earlier in your life, but you've got a life goes on. So you don't really, you know, you look back with great fondness, but you get excited by whatever it is that you're doing and you get excited by what's happening now and by what lies ahead perhaps. So to that extent, I wouldn't say I miss those days, but I remember them very, very fondly. And I remember them for a couple of reasons. I think the first is that I made lots of very good friends at the Institute, and it was also very humbling because, you know, for more, if I'm sure that if I wrote The Cat today, I would not get into one of these irons. It's much more difficult today than it might have been in my time. I was lucky I got into Ahmedabad, but I was, you know, once you go there, everybody thinks, "Hey, wow, you got into Ahmedabad." And you go there and you discover there are so many smart people, and you start wondering, "Am I good enough?" Okay. And you start looking at all the other people, and people have done so well in their lives, and they are so smart and so bright. But I think you learn to work with other people, and you learn to say that, look, everybody has their own strengths. Not everybody will be good at the same things. So I think it teaches you to respect other people's capability, respect other people's strengths, but never short sell yourself. Remember, you also bring something to the table. And I think learning to work as a team is really what success in life can be all about. Eventually, it's not competing with everybody. It's about how do you collaborate with other people to deliver results. And that's perhaps something that you learn when you're in business school. And that's something that stayed with me, certainly, as a priceless lesson. And good luck with your entrance exam. I hope you do well.
Yeah, I'm sure she is working hard. Well, the other question comes from Dr. Ajit Srivastav. He's a consulting scientist and also a soft skill trainer. He says that we often hear that leaders at the top are lonely. Is it true that when you climb that ladder and you reach the top, that height, you as a leader become lonely?
So it's probably true to a certain extent, because what happens is that sometimes leaders can start feeling that, hey, who can I talk to if I have a problem? And it's about saying that, you know, I have a set of, let's say, a board of directors who evaluates me, and I can't be telling them that I have a problem or I don't know what to do. And I have a team which is looking up to me for advice, so I can't be telling them, look, what do I do? So there are a lot of people, and certainly in the work that I do nowadays with some leaders, I see they can do with some help. They can do with someone who can either be a guide or a friend or a coach or a mentor. But I want to make the point that it doesn't have to be that way. And good leaders learn to be vulnerable. They learn to be with their teams, and they don't see it as, oh no, I have to be the smartest person in my team, because otherwise how can I be the leader? They don't think, I must have the answer to every question, otherwise how can I be the leader? I must be able to solve every problem, otherwise what will my team think of me? That's not true. Leaders learn that they are privileged to be responsible for the entire team, and their job is to work with the team to find the answers, to work with the team to solve problems. So it's perfectly all right for a leader to be able to say, I don't know, or oops, I'm sorry, I made a mistake. And as leaders learn to do this, as they learn to say, I'm sorry, I made a mistake, I think I called wrong, they will discover that the team says, all right, don't worry, I'm with you, I'll help you. You know, we're all together. And so it doesn't have to be that you will be lonely all the time.
So basically, we all are humans and we are not perfect. So we should, first of all, accept that we are humans. Another very good question that comes up is, youngsters are very easily impressed, but what happens is they seldom become inspired, and they don't understand that taking inspiration or becoming inspired will change lives. So how to take inspiration?
Interesting. They get impressed, but they don't get inspired. I think that's also about what happens with the people that you work with. And ideally, you want to work with people who inspire you and not just impress you. And I think it's therefore your turn to say, hey, what can I learn from this person? And not just look at them and say, wow, they're so good, but try and say, what makes them so good? What do they do that I could also try and do, and I could follow in their footsteps? So I think while you talked about that famous line about, you know, karun karo aur fal ki chinta mat karo, Unfortunately, we live in an era where everybody says, "Yeah, jaldi se fast forward karo, dikhao phal kya hai." You know, I'm in a hurry. I don't have time for all this karam stuff. Show me the phal. And it doesn't happen that way. Life doesn't work that way. So you've got to be willing to say, "What can I do?" So focus on the action. Focus on what they do, rather than on the results. So what happens to us is that we look at someone like a Steve Jobs. And we say, what a leader. You know, he set up a company like Apple. And you know what? He dropped out of college. So we start saying, acha, so if you want to be successful in life, you must drop out of college. Okay? And that's not true. That's not true. And I think you've got to be careful, therefore, that you look at people and try and understand what makes them tick, what makes them successful. And don't go blindly by everything they say or everything they do must be right. Try and use your head, try and use your judgment and say, hey, I don't think this works for me, or wow, I think this is something I like and I can relate to, and that's what I will do. So use your judgment and try and learn from other people, and that's perhaps a good way to get inspired to change.
Sir, another question, I believe this would be the last that I would take up, and that is from Dr. Akhil and from me. Dr. Akhil is Associate Dean with NMIMS Institute. And we both wish to ask one thing. What is your experience? How has been your experience of writing this book, The Habit of Winning?
I've enjoyed it thoroughly. I must tell you this, that it was a bit of a dream for me to be able to write a book. And so when I finally did manage to get a publisher and they said they would publish it, it was like, you know, what could be better for me? And I used to fantasize about this idea that, you know, when I'm gone, 7 years after I'm perhaps dead and gone, there'll be one grandchild who will climb up an attic and find this book and say, you know what, my grandfather wrote it. And to me, that's what life would be. Or, you know, even today, something that really delights me is when I probably get an email from somebody who says they read the book and they liked it. Or I meet somebody at an airport in the good old days, not anymore now for some time. And someone says, aren't you, you know, the guy who wrote this book, and I kind of like it and I enjoyed it. And to me, I feel really good that in some way, I might have made a difference to somebody else's life, because that's really what gives me my high. I get super excited. So I speak about what I've written in The Habit of Winning, and I write a bit here and there. And the only intent I have is that maybe somebody will take a lesson from here, which will change her life or his life. And if that happens, I'll probably say, wow, I've been lucky. That's really, so for me, it's been a dream come true. I must also tell you that, you know, for me, the book is not about saying I must write something which impresses people, since that word came up earlier. But it was about saying, how can I write a book that can help somebody in their journey? So I almost imagined that I was talking to my daughter, you know, and telling her, hey, here's what I've learned and here's what might help you in your life. I'm talking to my son and telling him that, you know what, this is what happened and this is what I did and this is what you might want to do. So it's a lot about having that conversation with someone who's close to me and someone who I care for, and I want that person to do well. So it could have been my son, it could have been my daughter, but it could have been any of you, it could have been anybody reading that book. And I'm trying to say, can I do something that can help you to get it right in your life? That's really been the intent. And if I succeed in even a very, very, very small way, and I discover that there is a girl in Indore who I had never known, who's now doing a, you know, a talk a book program and getting other people to say, hey, there's this book that I want to talk about. And that happens, I tell myself, I'm blessed. I've been lucky. And Arifa, I mean this, I think, you know, I'm so, so excited and super thrilled that you chose to kind of do what you do with this book. So thank you very much for that too.
Thank you so much, sir. I'm a big fan of yours, a big fan of the way you've written this book. Really, I tell you, if I have to write a book someday, I would definitely take a great lot of inspiration from this. Thank you so much for, you know, being a light in so many lives. I'm sure this book will make a difference in many people's lives. And your journey as a writer, this is what Afsana wishes to ask. So I think this has been your journey as a writer, means from the corporate world to coming and becoming an author. Thank you so much, sir, once again for joining my session. a very small initiative, but somebody like you joining means it's a big thing for me, and we are blessed. I'm indebted. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Arifa.
Have a lovely day.
And thanks, everybody. Enjoy the rest of your journeys and keep winning. Thanks once again, Arifa.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.